So welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallet and we're going to extend our series where we've been taking a look at C programming on the Raspberry Pi and take a look at how we can start using options to the program. We've already seen how we can supply arguments to our program, but if we start using lots of arguments, trying to maintain the correct order and the correct amount of arguments is going to become cumbersome. So this is where we can start using options. And we see options all of the time. Think of something like ls, ls minus l. The minus l is an option. We can use multiple options and we can supply these options in any order. We've also seen this with our compiler, the GCC. We've seen the options minus capital W for our warnings and the option minus O for our output file. And we can mix those options around in any order and we don't have to supply all of the options. So we're going to see how we do this with our C code. So let's go through and open ourselves a nice new source file. So we'll call it simpleoptions.c. That seems a great program name to me, doesn't it? Now let's go through and put ourselves a little bit of a comment so people know what we're doing. So we can then have a single line comment that says something like simple program to accept, let's say, a minus u for a user, minus g for a group name. So something simple to begin with, and we'll see how we can start developing this as we go through different scenarios. So we're going to include then our standard I/O, so pretty much you know that we're going to have this in many of our programs. But we're going to look at a new library that we're going to add in, so we're going to include the header file for getopt, and that's just in the singular. So getopt. So with our include statements done and dusted, we'll set up the main function. So we'll have it return an integer, and we'll look at some different return values as we go through this as well. We can say then that we're going to have our argument count being an integer. We're going to then have our character array, so we'll set this up for our arguments. So we still need to pass arguments, but some of those arguments can be options. And again, we'll go through and set up our main code block. And I like to end my brace brackets when we open them. Now within here, we're going to set up a few variables. So we're going to have an integer. So we can set up that integer to be the option index. You know, each one of the arguments that we supply will have an index value. So we can then iterate through all of those options or arguments that we've supplied. So we're just setting it here or instantiating it to a value of 0. This then stops a warning because we might be using then a variable that's not instantiated. We can go through and for the option, we'll just set up for minus u here, but we can set up minus u to perhaps take a user name. So we need to set up a character array for this, so setting ourselves up a string. But remember, we don't have a string data type, so it's just an array of characters. So we'll just call this then our username. And again, we'll instantiate this with a null value. Now we're going to enter our while loop. So the while loop is going to allow us to go through and read all of the arguments to see if there are any options that have been set. So as with conditions, we need our parentheses to enclose them, but also just for the true value here, we're going to set up another set of parentheses. So we're using the double parentheses and we're populating then the option index by going through and using getopt. And we're going through then looking at our argument count. So that's going to be the maximum time that we need to cycle through. So we don't need to cycle through any more arguments than we've got. We need to read from our argv. And then we can set the options that we want to look for. So we can say set g and u. I'm just going to put a colon after the U. A colon after an option value then specifies that it takes an argument. So we can supply a username. Now I can supply these in either way. In the blog for this, I've actually put U colon G. So it doesn't matter the order that we specify the options, but it does matter putting the colon in. So this then is the truth value, and then we're just looking it for it being not equal to minus 1. Obviously, once we get to minus 1, then we've gone past our zero index value. Again, we need to set up our brace brackets for the while loop, the code block for the while loop. And all that we're going to have within our while loop is a switch statement, and we're going to be examining the value that's stored in the index of the option index. For each item that we look at, and again we put in the code block for switch, we examine it with a case statement. So we say, well, is its current situation or its current case, is the case that the option index is set to U? So we go through and put that in quotes, and we then just have a colon to delimit it from the action that we want to carry out. So the code that we want for then it being you, we can populate the username by reading in the argument. So we just put then the option argument. So again, the U colon, when we define then the options can be supplied, sets up the option argument. So we populate then our variable. We go through and print out then our username. So we can use the printf statement. And we can go through and specify the user's name then, have a placeholder for our variable. So the %s, throw in a new line, we know the deal now. And then of course we're reading in the username into that first placeholder. So that's all the code that we really need to put in for this. But we also need to then say that we've finished with this case. And we do that within the C language by using the break statement. So we just go through and add in break and our semicolon. And then we can start looking for our option being H, or G rather. So we can go through and say, yeah, just look at the options we've said G and U. So we can then go through and specify. Now with this, we didn't specify that there was an option, so it's not G colon. So we just go through and specify then our printf and group is selected. So say this is a very simple example, but we just want to see it being used. In later examples, we can go through and do different calculations, being on the option being minus C or minus F, so we know which way we want to calculate or convert our temperatures. So we can say then that our group is selected. We can go through and put a new line. And then we're finished with this, but again, we need to add our break statement. Now they're the only options that we need. Any other option then is going to mistake. So we can pick this up with default. So it's still default colon. The colon is then just delimiting from our actions. And we can then go through and specify what we want to do if we hit the default, i.e. no valid option has been put in. So we can go through and put our printf statement and put, say, an incorrect option or whatever we want. But we're going to do something a little bit different that we haven't seen before. We're going to look more at the return value. So if I go through and do a return 1, we actually leave the main function and return a value of 1 to it. So our program is going to report an error, because technically then we have run the program incorrectly. So we don't want to return 0. So we leave the program at this point. Now I've already closed then my blocks. So I just need to make sure that I'm getting back into my main block of code. And we're going to have then our normal return 0. So if we get down as far as this, then we're going to return our normal 0 value to main. So we've got now a correct success and failure operation being controlled by our program. Now let's see how well our typing was. And again, we can take a look at our options here, because if I just use GCC, we've been providing the minus O option pretty much straight away, but I can mix things around a little bit. So I can go straight into my source code here, then use the minus O for the option. This then takes an argument, so it's going to be the output file that we want. And then my minus capital W and all. And again, I could mix the minus O and the minus capital W. Ooh, look at this. We've got some error. It's looked like I've missed out a semicolon before the while. So let's go back and fix this. Going back into Vim. Yeah, look at that username line. So let's add our semicolon in. So with the semicolon added in, let's jump out and save this and try and compile it again. So that seems a lot better. Now if we go through and perhaps run it with an incorrect option, so we go simple minus H, that doesn't exist, so we get our incorrect option. But now if we start supplying the minus G, we get our group selected. With the minus U, we can supply then our username and we get the user is Fred. We can also go through and supply both the G and the U. But don't forget then our return values. Let's look at how we can start making use of these return values. If we look at the last exit code, so if I use bash to echo out then the dollar question mark variable, and we can see then the last program exited with a value of zero. So that was our return zero statement. If I go back and run it as /simple, and if we go through and put then our incorrect option in, so like minus H isn't a valid option. If we go back now and look at our echo statement, you can see the return one coming out. So this is a way we can actually start telling the shell whether or not a program has succeeded. So we can see the importance of us controlling the return value so we can get a little bit of feedback to the shell and anyone trying to diagnose these issues. Now certainly I hope you found this useful and you are practicing your code at home. I look forward to seeing you again, and we're certainly going to have some more C tutorials coming your way.